Ladies and gentlemen and fans, if you would, a hand for the two competitors who played in this finals match tonight.
Last week, we talked about tennis superstar Naomi Osaka and her decision not to do any press at the French Open because she wanted to protect her mental health. Well, after she made that announcement, Roland Garros fined her $15,000 for skipping a news conference. The next day, she withdrew from the tournament. Osaka wrote on Instagram that since 2018, she's been suffering from bouts of depression and needed to take time away from tennis. We've seen how some interactions with the press can affect an athlete's mental health and leave them upset or even sad.
What do you feel caused that? Or was it just one of those bad days at the office?
I don't know. I'm done.
From where you stood on the court and from talking to him after the play, what's your reaction to it? What's your version?
What do you mean, what's my version?
Well, did he think that the game was tied, or did he think that you guys had it salted away?
How do I know that? I thought we were all aware of what was going on. That's my view. So I don't know what JR was thinking. I don't know the question you're trying to ask.
I was just trying to see if you knew exactly what his state of mind was. Did he think that you guys had it won, or did he think he was trying to make a play? No. Not sure.
What do you mean, I'm not sure? No, I don't know his state of mind.
Did you know if he knew the score?
Thank you.
That's one of my favorite moments in all of sports history. Okay. Osaka has been in the spotlight for playing tennis since she was 16 years old. She's been constantly bombarded by questions from the press, sometimes without any regard for her young age or her openness about having anxiety. I've always had a problem with the way we treat and commodify athletes, and their mental health is no exception to that. If Naomi Osaka had a broken leg or was even recuperating from an injury, concessions would have been made during the tournament and for the mandatory press conferences after a match. But given the stigma that surrounds mental health, we don't give someone the safety and support they need when dealing with depression or anxiety. And yes, definite strides have been made when it comes to acknowledging mental health and mental illness. But clearly, we still have a ways to go. Joining me now, back with us, Jemele Hill. She's a contributing writer for The Atlantic, host of the podcast Jemele is Unbothered, and co-host of Carrie and Jemele Won't Stick to Sports, and Dave Zirin. He's the sports editor for The Nation and host of the podcast Edge of Sports. He also wrote a great op-ed titled The French Open's Treatment of Naomi Osaka Hurts Athletes Everywhere. Jemele, I want to start with you since we talked about this last week when the story first developed and Naomi said she didn't want to do press events and press conferences. You were here talking about it. What is your response to what transpired in the story over the weekend?
First off, thanks for having me, and got to say what's up to my brother Dave Zirin, who I always enjoy being on air with. How you doing, Dave?
Doing well, thank you.
I'm just a little amazed that we have gotten to this point. It seems as if the officials at the French Open, and not just them, of all the leaders of all the major tournaments in professional tennis, they decided to bring a bazooka to a rock fight. And by trying to flex on Naomi Osaka and trying to show her who's boss and to put her in her place, they've had a situation that is now fully blown up in their faces. They have just shown how little they care and value the second-ranked tennis player in the world, someone who is slowly and wonderfully becoming the next woman up in this sport, and they have treated her poorly in this entire situation. You can't tell me that it's better for Naomi Osaka to not be in the French Open, all right? And so to me, it just seemed like there should have been a workable compromise in order to get and make sure that Naomi Osaka was a competitor in this. If she didn't want to do the press conferences, fine. Just continue to fight her the money and just move on. Or just come up with some kind of workable solution. The fact that it got to this point I put that squarely on the tennis officials in this sport.
You know, I feel like that's such a persuasive argument, Dave, because it feels to me like, you know, her not being in the French Open has to cost them more money than her not doing a press conference to promote the sport of tennis, which is the argument that they use as to why you need to do those press conferences after matches, even if you lose. You write in your op-ed that the French Open's treatment of Osaka is bad for all athletes, not just ones in tennis or female athletes who are already at a disadvantage. Why do you think that is?
Oh, there's something very nefarious afoot here, Zerlina, that goes way beyond issues of mental health and depression, although that should be enough, frankly, for this to be a settled issue. Okay, she's dealing with serious mental wellness issues. She says she can't do the press conferences. End of story. That's where this story should end. But there's something else going on here that I think is quite noxious. Naomi Osaka isn't just a rising tennis star. She's also someone who bulldozed the issue of Black Lives Matter into the country club, lily white world of tennis. She did that. It took a tremendous courage. It took tremendous bravery. And when I read the letter that was signed, not just by French Open officials, but the officials of Wimbledon, the US Open, Australian Open, saying, if you don't do these press conferences, don't bother showing up. We don't even want you in our tournaments. That to me was the killing of the ant with the bazooka. You know what I'm saying? And that to me is I think needs to be framed as part of a larger backlash against an athlete who dared upset the setup. I think there's something very ugly at work here where they're trying to get her to know her proverbial place when she has spent the last year saying she's going to be a different kind of athlete.
That's why I wanted to bring you on, Dave, because I feel like we touched on this, Jemele, in the conversation we had last week about how she's not just any professional athlete. She's Haitian and Japanese. She's a woman. And so her telling the sport, I'm not going to do a thing, is a thing that doesn't go over well when you're not a white man, and frankly. So, Jemele, speaking to Dave's point, do you think that a part of this is actually backlash to the Black Lives Matter protests and the fact that she was using her platform and the attention she gets as the number two player in the world to put a spotlight on Black Lives Mattering?
This is a reaction to just the very resistance of being Black and excellent. That's what this all is about. Like Dave said, this is about her support of Black Lives Matter, about her wearing the different face masks at the U.S. Opens with the Black victims of police brutality and also those who are wannabe law enforcers, if you will. So this has a lot to do with it. And it's a part of a changing culture that, frankly, establishments like the French Open and Wimbledon and all these long-standing establishment types are not comfortable with. The fact of the matter is a lot of athletes today, especially Black athletes, have more leverage, more power, and a strong social media following. They are able to dictate what they want to do on their own terms. And these leagues and organizations aren't really comfortable with that because they've never had to experience it. And what I love about today's athlete of Naomi Osaka's generation is that they are quick to tell you where you messed up at. And you know, I don't want to say messed up. And so she told them and flexed on them back and said, I tell you what, I will pull out of this tournament. Because the reality is, at least in the American sports landscape, tennis is not as widely popular, certainly not as the NFL or the NBA or any of the other major sports. They need a multicultural star like her to be at these events. So to even come at her as if they don't need her was just stupid.
See, that's why I have a Jemele Hill t-shirt.
It
in
is
my
stupid. I know, it is stupid. Sometimes you just got to say that. Dave, we only have one more minute. But one of the things I have been wondering, why don't they ask better questions at these press conferences? I bet she'd be more willing to participate if they didn't ask terrible questions. They asked bad questions.
Well, it's a tremendous scrum. It's an ordeal for the athletes themselves. And Naomi Osaka is being open about how it actually makes her feel as she's also dealing with these intersecting issues of depression and mental wellness and social anxiety. And I shouldn't be shocked, but I'm still gobsmacked that in this era where they're being so open about saying, oh, athletes, we want you to share your mental health concerns. It's so important. The leagues are going to put out PSAs. Oh, look, we just hired a mental wellness coordinator for our team. Well, when the road hit the car, they decided what side they were on. It came down to affecting both their pocketbooks and when it came time for them to discipline an athlete that they wanted to discipline. They did not hesitate to say mental wellness. What's that?
Well, they know now because she's at home and not at the French Open. And so the money they lost, I wonder if they're considering that. Jemele Hill, Dave Zirin, thank you so much for being here tonight for this conversation that we're going to continue having because maybe more will happen. Hi, I'm Zerlina Maxwell. Thanks for checking out our channel on YouTube. You can see more from Zerlina by clicking any of the videos on this screen and make sure you subscribe below to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories. Thanks for watching.